term fake news is a politically loaded one in today's world, especially in the conservative atmosphere of the United States or England. Although this modern sense of fake news, politically partisan disinformation created for propaganda, is usually traced to the successful campaign mounted by Rodrigo Duterte to become the president of the Philippines in the run-up to 2016, a 2018 study by the British Oxford University found that the majority of what they termed junk news on social media was consumed and spread by Donald Trump supporters. Likewise, the British decision to withdraw the entirety of the United Kingdom from the European Union faced multiple years-long probes into the use of disinformation during the election process, often emblemized by the infamous Brexit bus touring England emblazoned with inaccurate financial claims. Websites like Snopes.com exist today that deal primarily with fact-checking and debunking news stories mired in untruth. But the adage that a lie can run halfway around the world before the truth puts on its trousers still holds true. But before fake news became another culture war battlefield, the term was largely used synonymously with the notion of journalistic fraud, often with no specific partisan bias on a domestic level. Although William Randolph Hearst may never have actually uttered the phrase, "You furnish the pictures and I'll furnish the war," as a means to instigate the Spanish-American War, American involvement in World War I was certainly swayed by false reporting by John R. Ratham, and Nazi Germany specifically installed a Ministry of Public Enlightenment and Propaganda to control its news and media. Highly regarded newspapers and journals have not been immune to hoax reporting, with the Der Spiegel and New Republic magazines coming under fire for long-running fraud by noteworthy journalists Klaas Relotius and Stephen Glass, while noted educational publisher Prentice Hall were burnt with the release of the fraudulent diary Go Ask Alice. However, one such piece of fake news in the early 1980s had deeper and more insidious effects on the industry than the egg-in-the-face loss of prestige seen by these publishers. In 1981, a little boy named Jimmy died of heroin addiction in Washington, D.C., his short life profiled and eulogized by Washington Post reporter Janet Cooke in an award-winning piece of reporting. She highlighted the systemic problems of drug abuse in the city, but omitted the most obvious problem of all: that little Jimmy never existed. Jimmy is 8 years old and a third-generation heroin addict, a precocious little boy with sandy hair, velvety brown eyes, and needle marks freckling the baby smooth skin of his thin brown arms. That's how Janet Cooke's article Jimmy's World, published on September 28, 1980 in the Washington Post, began. Cooke paints the picture of a young addict hooked on heroin due to the influence of his young stepfather Ron, himself only 27. The two share an addiction, and Jimmy believes he will follow in Ron's footsteps by dealing the drug when he is old enough. As such, he still tries to pay attention to math lessons at school, but nothing else fazes him. Jimmy is portrayed in equal measure as precocious, an aspiring kingpin who knows his route to success, and tragic, an unwanted birth whose mother didn't even care to name him. He is so young that others have to shoot him up with the heroin to which he is addicted, assuring him that he will have to learn to do it himself when he is older. Cooke's reporting highlights the rising problem of heroin addiction in America at the time, pointing out the cheap supply of opiates from the Golden Crescent of Iran, Pakistan, and Afghanistan entering the country. She quotes DEA Special Agent David Kennedy, Harvard University Professor Dr. Alice Goulat, and Washington DC Coroner James Luke in quick succession to tie Jimmy's microcosm to the wider macrocosm of opiate addiction in the city. There may be something mawkish about watching Jimmy convulse as he shoots up, but she pulls the focus to something wider, holding the boy up as a sympathetic symbol of a much wider issue. Reaction to Cooke's story was immediate. In an outpouring of sympathy, city officials mounted a search for the young addict, led by then-mayor and political veteran Marion Barry. Barry, himself later indicted for drug use, was seen as the heart and soul of the District of Columbia, affectionately referred to as Mayor for Life. In a move perhaps influenced by Barry's status at the time as a first-term mayor under pressure from a public hungry for answers, he declared that the young boy had been found and was receiving treatment for his addiction, but had soon passed away. Meanwhile, the story was attracting some skepticism internally at the Washington Post, but was submitted for consideration for the Pulitzer Prize, a series of writing awards often seen as the premier prize for U.S. journalism. The submission was championed by the Post's assistant editor, Bob Woodward, who himself had made a name as one of the chief investigative journalists covering the Watergate affair a decade prior. 6 months after the article's publication, Cooke was awarded the 1981 Pulitzer Prize for feature writing, but by now the net was closing in. Janet Cooke, were you to ask her, would tell you that she had graduated from the prestigious Vassar College before earning a master's degree at the University of Toledo, winning awards for her student journalism at the Toledo Blade before she joined the staff of the Washington Post. And these details were included in the biographical notes attached to her Pulitzer win. Unfortunately for Cooke, this meant that her former colleagues and editors at the Toledo Blade were quick to spot the discrepancies between her account and the truth, that she had never graduated from Vassar and held only a bachelor's degree from Toledo. During the course of disclosing this fabrication to the Washington Post, Cooke also came clean about the fictional nature of her now prize-winning journalism. Within a week of receiving the Pulitzer, Cooke's editor, Donald Graham, held a press conference announcing the story's fabrication. He admitted that there had been doubts internally about its veracity, but defended the newspaper's submission for the Pulitzer on the grounds of its strength as a piece of writing, regardless of its truth. Later, famed Colombian author Gabriel Garcia Marquez concurred with his assessment, quipping that while it was unfair that Cooke won the Pulitzer Prize for journalism, it was equally unfair that she did not win the Nobel Prize for Literature. In the wake of the admission, Cooke resigned from the Post and returned the prize to the Pulitzer jury, where it was subsequently awarded to Teresa Carpenter for her coverage of the murder of actor Dorothy Stratton. In subsequent interviews with Phil Donahue and GQ magazine, Cooke explained her actions, chalking it up to the high-pressure atmosphere of the Post and the need for material, admitting that while she had heard stories of child addicts like Jimmy, she had fabricated the character after promising more of a story than she was able to deliver with her sources. The largest impact of Cooke's fabrication, however, may not have been the personal consequences she faced. While she relinquished her field's highest prize and no longer works in a writing-oriented career, she seems by most recent reporting to have moved on from the scandal and to have found a new life in which to thrive. But the nature of her scandal and the content of the story harmed the already precarious racial fabric of the United States for longer. Washington, D.C. has been a majority black city for decades, and Cooke herself is a woman of color. The article itself even at times seems hostile to the black community, including phrases like, "drugs and black folk been together for a very long time," uttered as though a witness statement. A statement from a fictional witness, taken directly from Cooke's mind. The perceived blackness of the affair was not unremarked upon at the time. An article for the National Association of Black Journalists, written in 1996, noted that other black journalists did penance for her sins, with black journalists, primarily women, finding new hurdles in their careers in the wake of the reputational damage caused by the Cooke scandal. Journalists now considered prominent in their field, including Michelle Martin of NPR and Jacqueline Thomas of the Detroit News, struggled with constant challenges to their credibility through the subsequent years. The Root, an online journal focused on African American matters, summed the story's legacy up thusly: her name has become synonymous with fakery and bad journalism. Her sins have cast doubts on a generation of black journalists. Journalism around the world is described as a fourth estate or fourth power. In addition to the divide of national power into executive, judicial, and legislative branches, the press and media are a fourth estate given the power of advocacy and political force. Just as a politician or judge is responsible for the people as much as for themselves, there is an implicit understanding that the press will not seek to actively harm the public or any segment of it. An understanding that seems to be diminishing year on year. Caveat lector.